As we gather together, I acknowledge the Ngunnawal and Ngambri people, traditional custodians of this land on which we meet. I acknowledge their care of the land and their relationship with the land for thousands and thousands of years. I pay our respects to their elders, past, present, and future, for they hold the memories, the traditions, the culture, and the hopes of the First Peoples of this beautiful country. And may we work together for justice and reconciliation. With reverence, we light our community candle, bringing us together in the light of God's love. We invite you to join me in the call to worship. Let us gather with hearts united, drawn together by the bonds of faith and the spirit of unity. For the early believers were of one heart and mind, sharing all we had, creating a harmonious melody of love. As we enter this sacred space, let us embrace the spirit of generosity and communal love, just as the early Christians did in Jerusalem. May our worship be a reflection of this fellowship and unity, where no one claimed private ownership, but all things were held in common. In this shared sacred moment, let us open our hearts to the transformative power of the Holy Spirit, who moves among us, binding us together in love. We come not as individuals alone, but as a community, where the needs of one are met by the abundance of another. Let our worship be a symphony of selfless love, echoing the chorus of the early believers, testifying to the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. Together, let us worship in unity, offering our hearts, minds, bodies, souls, and possessions, knowing that in our sacred devotion, we encounter the presence of the risen Christ. May our worship today be a testimony to the boundless hope, joy, grace, and faith that unites us over distance and time. One body, one family, gathered in love. Amen. Welcome, everybody, on this Canberra autumn day. We're never sure whether it's going to be raining or whether it's going to be cold or is it going to be hot. And welcome to all of you here in this community, but also on Zoom. Judith, Bette and Brian, Anne and Heather, as well as the people at Goodwin, welcome this morning. It's lovely to see you. The focus of today's service is community and light, as you will hear from the readings and from the reflection. I've added the hymns on the order of service so that those people who are on Zoom and who don't have a hymn book can join in, but just make sure you're on mute, as the timing will be different if you're singing along too. Pretend you're singing in the shower, maybe. And now I invite you all to pass the peace. May the peace and light of Christ be with you always. Let's join our voices in singing hymn 473 from TIS. It's on your order of service, so we don't need our hymn books today. A Community of Christ. One. I invite you to join me in this prayer. Thank you, loving God, for the harmonious symphony created when we, your children, live for each other, no matter our differences. In our diversity, you weave a tapestry of love, understanding, and compassion, echoing the beauty of your kingdom on earth. As we reflect on the goodness of unity, we offer our thanksgiving for the moments of laughter, hope, happiness, togetherness of comfort, strength, and the ability to share the weight of our burdens, which is found in genuine fellowship. Your presence among us, Lord, brings harmony to our gatherings and peace and joy to our hearts. May our gratitude be expressed not only in words, but also in our actions towards one another. Empower us to love sincerely, to forgive readily, and to bear each other's burdens willingly, embodying the harmony that the word we hear today celebrates. Thank you, Lord, for the precious gift of unity, a gift that reflects the essence of your nature. We are grateful for the fellowship we share as brothers and sisters in Christ, bound together by the love that surpasses all understanding. In Jesus' name, we offer this prayer of gratitude and thanksgiving. Amen. And again, let's join our voices to sing hymn number 474, Gather Us In. Invite John to come and give the first reading.
Our first reading is from the fourth chapter of the Acts of the Apostles. The whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul. And no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need.
Second reading comes from the opening verses of 1 John. We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the word of life. This life was revealed, and we have seen it and testified to it, and declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. What we have seen and heard, we also declare to you, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us.
And now a reading from the 20th chapter of John's Gospel. This is almost at the very end of the Gospel. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors were locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin and was one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you've seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now, Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples that are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may continue to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name.
The fourth reading is a passage called One, written by Aaron Harper. We come together as one, our hearts united to see the kingdom of love. We are connected as one. The universe evolves, our lives in its mould. And so we gather as one, no separation between black person or white, or man or woman. We live together as one, the earth our domain, origins the same. We are fine threads being interwoven in different shapes and different seams. We are fine threads, many colours, God's art piece, life's tapestry. Whatever race, whatever creed, whatever sexuality, whatever wealth, rich or poor, whatever power, great or small. Homeless people and climate change. War and torture, hunger and AIDS. Many issues we must face together to solve them. One human race. To join in the last sentence together, we come together as one, our hearts united to see the kingdom of love.
Thank you, John and Janet and Brendan and all the singers. That was really nice. That last reading I found when I was looking through the St. James songs, and it was a song that Aaron had written, but I thought that the words fitted really well. We didn't know what the tune was, so one day we might be able to sing it, but I just thought the words were just so lovely, and we would have it today. With those Bible readings, I did have a few to choose from, and I didn't want to go into in depth into the readings, because they do contain quite a lot in there about what we can do. So I could have had doubt, but I think I've done doubt before, and I'm sure we all have doubts that change from time to time as well. So I didn't go there. I chose community and light, as you might have gathered. Community and unity, and this is sort of partly from the Church of Scotland, because I always go there for what I want to say, and they're usually very good. That first piece was from them. The first welcome. What was it called? Call to worship was from there, and that was lovely. Community and unity. The readings from the Book of Psalms and Acts emphasize the beauty and strength found in the unity of God's people. In Acts, this is demonstrated through the shared life of the early Christians, and in Psalm 133, it's portrayed as a blessing from God. Fellowship with Christ. Both John 20 and 1, John stresses the importance of fellowship with Christ. 1 John speaks of the reality of this fellowship and the light of God dispelling darkness in the world. John 2:20 describes the peace and faith that results from encountering the risen Christ. And generosity and sharing. Acts 4 describes the generosity and sharing within the early Christian community, reflecting the selfless attitude of believers who consider others' needs as their own. And as it happens, today is also World Health Day. And here is something about communities and about the benefits of communities the benefits of community for our health. Communities, they can help us to feel we're not alone in our struggles. A community can also help us to develop a sense of identity. When we're part of a community, we learn about shared values and beliefs. Communities also provide better mental health. Extensive research surrounding mental health has concluded that mental health is equally as important as physical health. Being part of a community can have a positive effect on mental health and emotional well-being. It provides a sense of belonging and social connectedness. It can also offer extra meaning and purpose to everyday life. Communities can exist or be created from a shared location, hobbies, lived experiences and backgrounds, or a common cause. For many people, communicating with others through online forums, social media, or in person can help them to have a healthier mindset, improved self-worth, and greater enjoyment of life. Here at Woden Valley Uniting Church, we have a community of faith. We make this place sacred every Sunday. We use our banners, our candles, the cross, our lovely table that we have, our beautiful quilt, and the other accoutrements there. But what really makes it is us, this community, that gathers together each Sunday to acknowledge and share our faith, to sing together, to pray together, to share our concerns, to share our joys and sorrows. We appreciate our diverse gifts and value our commitment. One other thing that we do is share coffee and tea together every Sunday. And a big thanks to the people who actually volunteer to provide that and make it happen. There are several other times when food and drink is shared, whether it be a cup of tea or instant coffee and a Scotch finger, wine and cheese, or a meal together. Sharing food and drink is a time when stories are shared, troubles voiced, jokes told, and listening is done. And I'll bet most people find that the sharing the food and drink is also a very important part of being in community. I know I benefit greatly from being part of this community. I feel safe, accepted, cared for, and listened to. And it gives me a sense of purpose, among other things. I know my children are grateful too that I am part of this community. They know there are people who care about me and can call on if needed. I remember years ago, probably about 2 or 3 years after my husband died, and I had thought to spend Christmas with my sister over in the UK, but I didn't want to leave my kids. My daughter Kate said, "It's okay, Mum, you go. We'll go to church on Christmas Day and someone will take us home for Christmas dinner." Faith and trust in that community. I didn't go on that occasion. I waited for my 70th birthday to do that. But I also belong to lots of other groups, communities, the book group, walking group, craft groups. And to a certain extent, I have a similar feeling, but it's not quite the same. What makes this, our community, different? Here's a piece from John O'Donoghue. "One of the great dreams of humanity's is the founding of a perfect community where longing and belonging would come to sublime balance. From Plato's Republic to the basic community in Latin America, of contemporary times, the relation of this ideal has continually called the human heart. In the Christian story, it is the dream of the realization of the kingdom of God. The perfect community would be a place of justice, equality, care, and creativity. Humans have wonderful abilities and gifts, yet our ability to live together in an ideal way seems undeveloped. All community life seems to have its shadows and darkness. In contrast to many communities in nature, human intensity in its brightness and darkness makes it difficult to envisage an ideal community." When you examine closely any piece of field or bog, your eyes slowly begin to discern the various communities of insect, bird, animal, and plant life that coexist together. What, at a glance, seems to be just another bit of field reveals itself as finely tuned miniature community. Each little self has its own space and shelter. It is an organic and diverse community. If humankind could only let its fear and prejudice go, it would gradually learn the inestimable richness and nourishment that diversity brings. Community can never be the answer to all our questions or all our longings, but it can encourage us, provoke us to raise questions and voice our desires. It cares for us, whether we know it or not. And how do we here, as the Woden Valley Uniting Church and as individuals, help share the dream of the kingdom of God and bring God's light to the world? I think we all strive to do that in a number of ways. As a church, we turn up here on Sundays, that's for one. We have a mission plan, especially concerning the block and other things. We donate to wider work. We support Woden Community Service and the Little Pantry. We join in carols on the block and the Pierce Community Carols. That's just to name some of the things. And thanks mainly to John, Zooming plays a huge part of our extending into the wider community. We reach out to so many others using Zoom. I do have to say that while Zooming took off and it was a great tool to keep us in touch as a community when we were in lockdown and couldn't meet in person, and we still use it as a convenience of Zooming for a number of our meetings, etc., the downside is we no longer have our shared cups of tea. What do we do as individuals? Well, we volunteer, we donate to worthy causes, we attend and march in rallies, we write letters to politicians, we join groups, we talk to people. And I'm sure that there's lots more that we all do. I don't know if you want to mention a few of the things that you do. Maybe I've mentioned them all. Do you think we could do more to spread the light of Christ in the world, especially as a church? We can always do more. There is always more to do. In my mind, a good way to start would be to continue building the faith and trust in our community, Woden Valley Uniting Church, and I think the rest will follow. At prayers, Libby will have a time of silence and you'll be invited to light a candle signifying where you see God's light is needed. But I want to read a little story from Val Webb, and I quote, "My six-year-old grandson was very excited recently when he came third in a colouring competition at a holiday campground. He is highly intelligent, as all our grandchildren are, but was, at that stage, rather swift with his artwork. He had more urgent things to do. After thinking about his third place for a while, he said to his mother, 'I guess the other two stayed in the lines better.' And when he came home from holidays, he showed me the diary he had dictated to his mother each day, and on the colouring day he had written, 'I coloured a picture and stayed in the lines.' How early we learn the insider-outsider rules. Much of Christian theology has been about staying in the lines. And as we have seen, when people have tried to colour outside them, more energy is expended rubbing out wandering lines than seeing a new picture we create." So I just really loved that story and just imagined lots of lovely, colourful scribbles. As a progressive uniting church, we have moved somewhat outside the conventional lines of Christian theology. I'm wondering if we can be brave enough and have energy enough and vision enough to move a bit more out of those lines and create a new picture of Woden Valley Uniting Church. Just a thought. I know that when we have the block done and there's accommodation, we will have the opportunity to be more diverse and stretch our lines. but I wonder if we can make some small marks outside the lines in the meantime. The council is always ready to hear some ideas. I leave you with these questions to think about. What makes this community different from others? And what can we do to grow the faith and trust? How far can we spread God's light? I also leave you with the certainty of God's love, the certainty that we have a rich and nurturing community in our church that abides by our slogans. Jesus practiced radical inclusion and all are welcome here, and dare to question and to act. Amen. It's now time to take up our offering. As you see, we've got a couple of bags there for the little pantry as well. And I know that there's a whole lot more out there too. So you'll have a busy time, Joan and George, taking it down to Warren Community Service. Loving God, we bring the offerings of this community of faith. Not only do we bring our money, we bring our time, our skills, our thoughts, ideas, and our care for the world around us. Today, on the first Sunday of the month, we acknowledge the items for the little pantry which are donated to help alleviate some of the distress in the Woden community. Now let's join together in the lovely song from Aaron. Libby will lead us in our prayers of the people.
To start with, in keeping with
Joan's comments, I can't help but see how large the flame in our new community candle is. It's absolutely staggering. At the end of these prayers, there will be a brief pause for people to add their own prayers. And if you want to, you could get up and light a candle, yet another flame. Today we pray for unity among us all, communities which work together and support each other as brothers and sisters should within families. We intercede for those who feel lonely or isolated. Wrap them in the warmth of your love and guide us to be instruments of companionship and support. May we actively seek out those in need and extend the hand of friendship. We pray for those facing adversity, illness, and distress. And within our own community, we pray particularly for our friend Molly and for Lynn, who are both seriously ill. Grant them the strength to endure. Help us as a community to be channels bringing practical help and compassion to those in need. As, for instance, we can help those in economic distress with our donations, especially to the Worden Community Service, and in our attempts to offer shelter to those in need. Lord, we bring before you the broken relationships within our communities. Within our own country, we ask for healthy, thriving relationships between neighbours. We pray different cultures will be able to understand and care for one another in our community. We pray that the diversity of your people will be celebrated by all, just as you affirm and love each one of us. Lord, this is a time of much world turmoil, both war and disaster. Help us to remember and pray for all communities who struggle with great difficulties, not just those prominent in the news, but all countries facing community disruption, invasion, famine, natural disaster. We especially pray for guidance for those in authority in these communities. May they create harmony, not division or war. Please grant us leaders who help the needy and lead to good for those in their countries, not to war driven by ideology and ambition. Give us the strength to pray for our leaders and bless them, even when it's hard. Heal wounds, reconcile hearts, and inspire forgiveness. May the love that binds us together overcome any discord. And now, Lord, we bring before you the names and situations that lie heaviest on our hearts. Hear our prayers. You have always shown us the way from darkness into the light. For those struggling now to see the light, we ask that you shine it a bit brighter in our world. Grant us all the grace to see a way forward through the present darkness. And now let's join together in the Abba prayer. Heavenly Father, Heavenly Mother, holy and blessed is your true name. We pray for your kingdom and peace to come. We pray that your rule will be done. Let earth and heaven become one. The bread we need, give it to those who have none. Let forgiveness flow like a river between us, from each one to each one. Lead us to holy innocence, beyond the end of our days. Come swiftly, Mother, Father, come. For yours is the power, the glory, and the mercy. Forever your name is all in one. Amen. And now let's join our voices together in singing the song, Christ Be Our Light, by Bernadette Farrell. It's on your order of service.
Oh,
the blessing. Remember, God loves us. May the spirit of unity hover over our hearts like a gentle dove, knitting us together in the love of Christ. May our bonds of fellowship be strong, our understanding deep, and our shared purpose unwavering. May the peace, grace, strength, joy, and love given so freely by God be our constant companion, not to be kept, but to be offered in fellowship and shared with all whom we meet. Amen. Amen. And now the going out and the postlude. I want, in the words of Charles Wesley, let us sing together lustily and with good courage. Tis 666. I just want just sing the verse twice, and we'll sing. We are dancing in the light of God, not marching. Dancing is much less. What's the word? It's more inclusive. Okay, tune.